life and but most fundamentally true to the subject of today's exchange, a highly ethical career. I find a lot of familiar faces, people who are known to me in the bar, a lot of fresh young, very interesting, very, very inspiring to see young faces in the court. And I must say, the face of the court is changing in more than one sense. And it's important it changes. And lectures like this are far from the immediate practical utility of sitting for the examination. You know, that's why probably most of you are here today. And to see if, from what we discussed today, possible hints into the questions and that you ask by any examiner. So none of us know what questions will be asked, but I remember a couple of years ago when I was not sitting in that question paper. The questions in the lecture room, sir, would you know what questions are likely to be on the question paper this year? I said, for your convenience, I spoke to the person who was setting the question paper and asked him if he can help me with his mind on the examination. He was very kind enough to share some insights, which of course I did not disclose so directly and openly as the questions that are likely to be asked, and I tried to convert them into possible issues. And I remember I got a lot of thanksgiving much later in the question paper. Anyway, if this is not an occasion, then you will be talking about professional ethics in the context of an examination, which is a very pressing concern for every one of us. A career after long years of study in law schools and coming from different walks of life and with expectations as to grow, to mark a good graph, career. And if it had not been so, I would have probably talked about professional ethics and ethics, etc., from a classroom perspective. And I know there are many law schools today and some law universities have a subject on professional ethics. But how seriously they are taken in the classroom and how deeply you imbibe what is taught in the classroom, I try to digest them, internalize them as part of your professional career is a big question mark. Since I keep visiting a large number of law schools, universities, and law colleges, and we keep getting a lot of interns, you know, with too many question marks up in their heads, and the intent to learn, the desire to learn, the keenness to do something in life, all that is common to every one of us, big or mighty, low or small. But let me try to fusion both some theoretical aspects and what may possibly come in the course of an examination so that you are not left completely unhappy at the end of the lecture. So let me try to do that. But before I thought it's important to have some very broad sweeping understanding of why we need to look at professional ethics at all. Now, it is said the story goes back to the Ten Commandments. Those of you are familiar with the Ten Commandments, Commandment number 9 and 10. So Commandment number 9 says, thou shalt not be a false witness against thy neighbor. And Commandment number 10 says, thou shalt not covet the property of your neighbor's wife, your neighbor's servant, your neighbor's so-and-so. So these two commandments, look at how they got translated into the general life of the community virtually in all parts of the world. I'm not trying to say that all civilizations all over the world has heard the Ten Commandments in which you're part of it. Every civilization, every community had their own moral underpinnings. And today, if you look at the study of neuroscience, of people looking at how brains behave, and ask questions, what is this great thing called moral behavior? And how does minds tend towards a certain conduct, good or bad? Not necessarily going into the Garden of Eden and eating the forbidden fruit, but beyond that. So there is something deeply inherent in our mind to look at and also endorse good conduct, either from a utilitarian point of view or from any other point of view, and to negate and to proscribe conduct which is injurious, bad, so on and so forth. English language uses all kinds of words to express the same thing. So in fact, there's a problem of language again. So when you talk of these origins of some of these ideas of morality, a good deal of literature and professional ethics addresses these concerns. So some people say ethics is an applied principle of morality. So ethics is like having practical guidelines as to how you behave. It's all right to say in the law of contract, thou shalt not commit a breach of contract on the basis of deceit or misrepresentation. So what is this deceit and misrepresentation? Not to lie to a person who is engaged in a contractual relationship with you. So lying is fundamentally forbidden. But lying takes so many forms. You look at the law of contract, law of fraud, things like that, you'll have case law after case law where people have committed deceit and fraud on each other. So what is forbidden as a moral precept is still practiced by people. So where does the lawyer comes in? Because if people commit deceit and fraud on each other, then law comes in and says that there shall be a consequence of what you do. So in a recent book, somebody writes about the fidelity of lawyers. One Mr. Wendell written a book called The Fidelity to Law. The most important thing of lawyer's preoccupation as a lawyer is a fidelity to law. And that raises a very important question. I mean, what is law? Fidelity to law is fine. And suppose I have a serious problem of a domestic conflict, and two parties are equally powerful monetarily, but wronged by each other, let us say. And we have a law on the one hand with them, partly with the other, partly with one. And we have a difficult choice as to whom to defend, to what extent. So even though academics and legal ethics scholars may say that in contemporary time, unlike, let's say, I'll give you a few examples of what happened about professional ethics long ago. In somewhere in the 12th century, you know, in England, we, apart from the early emergence of the courts of kings, the king's courts, etc., there were the ecclesiastical courts, the church courts, and where mostly private disputes were sought to be resolved. And when Oxford priest wrote a book in somewhere in the 12th century on ethical lawyering, imagine that in those days when lawyering was confined to only resolving very narrow domestic rather local disputes, somebody was thinking about the ethics of lawyering. And that book talks about the excessive charging by lawyers. I mean, imagine in 12th century, the law is not even an organized profession. So these various aspects or facets of a person engaged in the pursuit of knowledge, acquisition of knowledge, and orderly presentation of such knowledge for the utility or the use of a third party, if that was not even organized at that point of time, people were talking about excessive fees being charged. It denotes something so fundamental about the proclivity of the human mind to be, while in the process of helping somebody, to help oneself. So somewhere in the 14th century, another book was written, again in England. You said were charging fees. The expression was, before the patient dies, get your hands full. So look at what's happening. You'll find large number of literature, again, both humorous and serious. And lawyers' misconducts, lawyers pleasing clients, and very, very outrowing, laughable instances. I think Mark Allen had written a book a couple of years ago, collecting almost a universal from all parts of the world, jokes on lawyers. It's very interesting to see how the legal profession has been for a long time the butt at the end of a criticism, sometimes rightly so. So, but why therefore it's important to talk about the ethics of lawyering? And if you talk about the fidelity to law, it's not easily answered. I keep every case, for instance, day before yesterday, and you keep your eyes open to what happens in the court. So as I was arguing a matter, the counsel on the other side, very fairly probably, to present that point of view that whether that friend is misleading the court. This, of course, this kind of expression you hear every second and third day in every second and third case. And we hear it from the counsel on the other side. And why do we keep doing it? If at all we don't do it, then why should somebody else talk about it like that? And it and the matter, I keep watching the court. While I keep waiting for my case, I keep watching the court, how young budding lawyers behave, how very well experienced lawyers also equally behave in the same, the same way which we think is not fair and good. I think it's important to notice all that and to learn from that. These are all very broad observations before I come to some very serious questions. So when we observe in contemporary times, we talk about practicing in the trial court, practicing in tribunals, practicing in the high courts and Supreme Court, the nature of practice obviously varies. And because it varies, do we say that we can have different principles of ethics and professional conduct? Obviously the answer will be no. But at a point of time when the study of law was only confined to litigating in trial courts, we had our first high court in 1860, the Chartered High Court set up in 1860, and much later from 1860 onwards, the Calcutta, the Madras, and the Bombay High Courts. And we practice in the high courts essentially appellate, essentially civil and criminal appellate jurisdiction. And people studied law only for the purpose of walking into the courts and acting as pleaders or lawyers to defend, to engage in litigation work. But all of us know that today litigation work is not the only avocation of a person equipped with the, study of law. Wide range of opportunities for lawyering, to put it in a wide expression, are available today. And then do we say that because wide range of opportunities are available, people who work in law firms, people who work in transactional and law work, people who work as in-house attorneys in companies and corporations, and people who work as mediators, people who work, as litigators in court, people who work as private counselors. So, can ethics differ from people to people? Perhaps not, and perhaps I don't know. So we have to have a complete relook at the whole issue of the role and the ends of the profession. Because if study of law was mainly to get into litigation at some point of time, which is no longer the position, if that was the end and purpose of law, then your narrow focus on ethics is understandable. And perhaps if no part of the world today had written constitutions, we would not be talking about fundamental freedoms. We are not talking about social development, social change, equality, dignity, so on and so forth. The constitution therefore today asks us to have a complete relook at what's happening in the society and be part of a great social movement and change towards what the constitution promises, an egalitarian society. So the promise of law today is not merely to the a practice in the court, the promise of law today is a part of a process, a larger process of social change. See, that is the promise of law, and which is enacted through constitution. And the whole process of lawmaking and law enforcement, then can we say that all those old principles of professional ethics and legal ethics have undergone a change, and we need to have redefine ethics from radically and fundamentally different points of view or perceptions? A very important question to ask. Why do you ask this question? Let's say questions, issues like the uniform civil code issue, which has raised our courts for quite some time, or take equality between sexes. And all of us know that, I don't know how many of you are familiar with Ronald Dworkin, a great American jurist. And one of his theses was that in hard cases, there is only one right answer. So it's a huge debate in USA, and whether in hard cases there can be only one right answer. I think even in simple cases we have more than one good answer, because we generate answers. So if constitution is the ultimate rule of law, and the constitution calls upon the legal profession to march along with the constitution, and every aspect of the constitution has more than one debatable dimension, I ask myself the question, so what is fidelity to law? Fidelity to which part of the law? Fidelity to which dimension of the law? That which advances, let's say, the right of women, more against men occupying certain public spaces, the right of children against trafficking and exploitation, as against, for instance, or the right of industries, set up industries, as against right of environment. So we have very difficult questions to answer. And these questions are not answered only through what happens in courts of law. What happens in courts of law, or the final, you know, drama which goes on, where everything, you know, takes shape, and we try to give a final shape to what happens outside. So the lawmaking process, how community understands the law, how community would like to participate in the lawmaking process, the enforcement of law, and what are the narrow or the broad roles of courts in resolving this very controversial social issues. In the midst of all this, I think we need to sit back and ask this question as to how we redefine the role of the profession in contemporary times. It's a very important, fundamentally important for us to be a good professional. Now, when we talk about it, I keep reading very often a very enlightened book written by one Krishnaswamy Iyer, somewhere in 1944. He was a leading lawyer in the Madras High Court, and Justice Maurice Gaya, who was the Chief Justice of the Federal Court, had written a foreword for this book. And these lectures were given somewhere in the 1940s. I just read out to you how the concerns expressed at that point of time seem to be beyond time, seem to be so contemporary. This is what Justice Maurice Gaya writes about this book and the lectures. I've heard Indian friends of my own, themselves distinguished lawyers, deplore in no uncertain terms this lowering of standards. And it seems clear that one cause of it at least is a great overcrowding of the profession and a struggle for existence among its less fortunate members. Since the weaker brethren are thereby exposed to temptations which they are not always able to resist. This is a matter which affects the public as well as the profession itself. For any diminution in the respect for our lawyers and the old must affect prejudicially the whole administration of justice, 1944 to 2020. Do you hear the same thing kept talking about in law schools or in public platforms? I think yes, people talk about it. That means if at a point of time constitution was not born in our country, the whole orientation towards social change was yet to be, you know, redefined. If this was a perception about lawyers, and if with all these 60, 70 years after what he spoke, we are still probably the same kind of crossroads. So what has gone wrong or what has not gone right? So I think both are important questions. Bear it in mind that this kind of observation or perception is not peculiar to India. There is a journal called Legal Ethics, and this journal publishes stories about what's happened in all the Commonwealth countries. I keep reading it to understand what's happening in the profession. I brought one of the latest issues here for you. So this issue talks about the misconduct and the degrees of professional competence, the lack of it, in different Commonwealth countries. I come across cases where somebody is warned for 17 times in his career of 20 years and still doggedly pursuing unprofessional conduct. I come across a case in USA where a person representing the cost of a refund of an income tax at the end of the day, after 10, 12 years of, say, a long drawn adjudication before the revenue authorities. So he tells his client that you're getting a refund. You're not liable for any additional assessment. The client was so happy, and the refund is said to be some $20,000. So much later, he gets another communication with the complete details of the bills sent by the lawyer to the client. This story is now, you get not only a refund of $20,000, they now understand that they have over-assessed you, we're getting $50,000 back, and my charges are exactly $50,000 plus so-and-so pences. This issue goes before the disciplinary committee. A huge case arises out of this. And I know that all of us here, I could see many of you who come from very, very good, reputable, middle class and higher middle class families who have been exposed to a lot of family values. And I'm sure in our country, I've not come across large numbers of instances of this kind of, professional misconduct. That's why he's talking about the temptations for the weaker brethren. So those of us who are not fortunate enough to get quickly rise in the bar and in the profession. And many of us do not have the opportunities. And the leading lights of the bar, with whom maybe we are working, or who see every day in the court, or we talk about, being reported about in the press and the media. So they seem to be the kind of a high watermark for our achievements. Sometimes they wonder, is it correct? Perhaps it's not. That's where professional ethics comes in. It comes in because we are not chasing, let me say, use a very controversial expression, we are not chasing false gods. There are several false gods in the profession. Arun Shaw has written about it in the title of his book. So we must have our own gods. We must be our own gods in the profession. That is ultimately his professional ethics. Having said all that as an introduction, since I promised that we will talk about your current concerns of the examination, and let me quickly take you through a few possible subjects which can be a good issue for a question paper by any wise question paper setter this year. And unfortunately for you, I have not spoken to any one of them to find out what is there in their mind, but I suppose I can guess. I myself sent question papers in the past several years, and I picked up some of them, spoke to some of them, and I could gather that possibly these issues can qualify as good questions for this examination. Let me quickly read what I have written, in an order which I think I have not written down here. With the expansion of human activities and with the emergence, I'll have it circulated for you, it's not an issue. With the expansion of human activities and with the emergence of wide range of professions, people are beginning to write about professional ethics, touching virtually upon every profession. There are books on the ethics of the engineering profession, We all know about the Hippocratic Oath, which doctors take. There are books about the medical profession ethics. Many of us know the medical malpractices industry in USA. The ambulance chaser is a famous expression. The compensation medical malpractice industry is, you know, has given rise to a large volume of literature. Then we have all kinds of other services in the community. Those who provide, let's say, there's a recent book written by a New York journalist on Google, Amazon, and Facebook, how they're virtually the masters of our knowledge. We all talk about privacy, right to privacy, no? Probably it exists only at an illusionary level. Google, Amazon, and Facebook know everything about each one of our minds. What I do on my, you know, iPad or Apple instrument, and therefore, like, you remember the famous author who wrote 1984.
George Orwell.
So, 1984 and Animal Farm were books written around the time when Soviet Russia was a Bolshevik, a communist country. So, George Orwell said, probably tomorrow there can be a thought machine which can be put in every room, let's say in a prison. It can read your thoughts. So how dangerous it is. So today it's coming true. Therefore, information, wherever it is stored, in whichever form, whatever profession it is stored, is not very safe in people's hands. Therefore, people are talking about the professional virtues and ethics of virtually every human activity. But some people say the profession of a lawyer stands out very differently from the other professions. Can we have an answer for the distinction? Why is that the profession of a lawyer or a legal service is qualitatively distinct from any other profession? Can we attempt an answer to that question? Why is it so? And why is it so important? The right to health of every human being is served by a very honest medical practitioner. You all know about, human transplant stories. We all know there's a law about it. We also know there's a lot of laws relating to health and public health and private health. Laws relating to hospitals, dispensaries, and medical termination of pregnancy, so on and so forth. So a doctor plays a very important role in human health. But the professional ethics of a doctor is probably confined to the health aspect of the community. But you touch upon a lawyer, I think today there is no activity of a human being in any civilized community which is not affected by law. Except the narrow confines of our private homes, where we spend a little time on our dinner tables, our conversation with those talking about the rest of the world, or in our prayer halls or our temples and churches, where law does not, you know, invade too obtrusively. So except these very narrow spaces, law virtually touches upon every aspect of our life. And why does it touch so? I remember reading a book about, an American author, talking about how too much of law in USA has virtually robbed the fundamental propensity of human beings to be in good moral agents. Why do I say all this? Because if law virtually touches every aspect of our life, and without that kind of a rule of law being absent, we do not know what kind of a social order we may have. Therefore, on the one hand, we need rule of law for every aspect of our life. But then one law invades, there are too many problems. That is where I think the important distinction of how lawyers play a role in everything about law, the lawmaking process, the understanding of law, the enforcement of law, the realization of purposeful and important objectives of law, and so on and so forth. So which is virtually everything about communities, you know, well-being, which perhaps may not be the same as about an engineering profession or a medical profession or a chartered accountant profession, though all of us again know that in each one of them, if they don't behave well, may have havoc for a community. If the chartered accountant don't behave well, we have issues like Enron, right? and or Mr. Ragat Dokta, and you know, issues like that. So somebody insider trading. I brought for you a book written recently by a well-known district attorney in New York called Preet Bharara. I don't know how many of you have heard about him. He was reputed to be a very strict attorney who brought the book several erring public men, including Senate members or representatives in the New York assembly, and lot of well position persons occupying high positions in public life. And he tells us about this through his book, the lack of health, of the profession, in the sense that the accountability of the profession can become a serious question mark if you don't practice certain fundamental virtues. And ultimately, at the end of the book, what you find is to talk about honesty. Honesty, truthfulness, virtue, morality, and then advancing the objects and purposes of law without excessive zeal in promoting what you seem to be just. All of us know that public prosecutors very often are tempted to get a conviction. The investigating officers, virtually stand on their heads to see that the convictions come. But that's not what a public prosecutor is supposed to do. And he talks about case after case where the concept of accusation, how do you accuse somebody of a wrong? Today, it's not necessarily a civil wrong, a criminal wrong, it can be any wrong, a social wrong. The Supreme Court is full of all that in the past couple of years. I'm tempted to call Supreme Court as a social workshop. So a lot of activities are taking place. None of us ever imagined when I came, for instance, about in 1979 to this institution, I never thought I'll be probably lecturing one day like this on talking about Supreme Court as a social workshop. So things have changed. The court space is changing, the law is changing. Constitution looks at the role of the law in a huge way. Unimagined when even the members of the Constituent Assembly never thought about. So if today Ambedkar or Masani or Kamath or Allah de Krishna Mayer were to be here today and looking at what Basu's digest of constitutional law, they would be astonished. Probably they say, this is not the constitution we wanted to write. But that's how it is. So in the midst of all this, so how do we say that the profession of law is something unique and distinct? And therefore, the ethics of the legal profession will have to be seen from very, very different and significantly different perspectives. There was an American, very interestingly, unlike England, which is the birthplace of the common law system, the adversarial system, you don't find the enormous literature on professional ethics in England. But America is full of it. It's full of it. It's very, very interesting. There was a judge called Judge George Sarsfield. He was the Chief Justice of Pennsylvania, Supreme Court, somewhere in the mid-1850s. And all that the American Bar Association has written about the, canons of codes of conduct, etc., are borrowed from his essay written somewhere in 1860s. George Sarsfield, he was the Chief Justice of the Pennsylvania Supreme Court. He was alive to two important questions. One, that the role of a counsel is to promote and advance the interests of a client. I do not know how many of you are familiar with one English lawyer and also a lord called Lord Brougham in the famous Queen Caroline's case. He said, the advocate does not know anybody else except the face of the client. And somewhere in the course of that case, the expression came, lawyers are hired guns. Lawyers are hired guns. So that's what was happening about the legal profession's image. So this George Sarsfield was alive to all that. And also he thought adversarial system has the potential of dividing similar thinking people into two camps. We study the same law in the law school with the same teacher. We look at the same digest of cases. we form our own perspective and understanding. But you stand on either side, but they are not differing sets of people, or mind is divided. So it takes place because the system, an adversarial system, commands us to think differently, depending upon which side of the court you are. So Saraswati said we will have to harmonize both of them. Lord Brahma's higher can issue, and the adversarial system containing the potentials of dividing the thinking process into two camps, we have to harmonize both of them. Are we able to do it today? I do not know whether we are able to do it today, whether we have done it at all. The very hugely controversial voices on this question. So therefore look at that. Whether because of the adversarial system, unlike what happens in the trial court and the appellate court, the implications of an adversarial system is that truth is best discovered by competing minds engaging in presenting competing points of view. We have some kind of an idea, like how many of you are familiar with the definition of proof in the Evidence Act? Pick up that very interesting provision. It has so many subjective facets built into that provision. But still, the evidence law says proved is what the magistrate ultimately thinks is proved according to him or her. It's a very interesting definition. So in the context of a trial process and appellate process, you find how the law moves or the working of the law happens. The discovery of truth of the trial process is served best by very highly influential thinkers that the adversarial system promotes the discovery of truth. As you move up in the hierarchy of courts, the first appellate court, then the second appellate court, and ultimately in the Supreme Court, how efficient or how important or how contributory is the adversarial system, let's say in Supreme Court. Supreme Court, the judges do not discover truth the way a magistrate discovers truth. High courts, the judges do not know what is the truth except an affidavit filed before the High Court and Supreme Court. So what is truth? What ultimately is a fact? So good part of a litigation in the High Court and Supreme Court is not based on the law of evidence. It's based on some other practice, customs, principles evolved over a period of time. So affidavits occupy the major part of a discovery of truth, engine. So then, what is the role of an adversarial system? Do you think in Supreme Court we need to have a different kind of a system? Sometimes I wonder the adversarial system in Supreme Court perhaps is not all that good for the court. Perhaps it's not all that good for the clients. So we are not here to not only to make a good living for us, certainly having studied law and wanting to embark on a good profession, it's fundamental human desire and a craving that we make a good living. Nothing wrong about it at all. But how do we really say that in the context of a system which is so adversarial, we can still be honest, good, truthful professionals? How do you make it possible? So what are your comments on this? This is not something very academic, not philosophical. I have come across it, and I come across it every day. Not only when I take up cases, but also when I watch other people. So it's not an imaginary issue. Only we have not perceived it. We have taken it for granted. We have simply taken it for granted. Once you perceive it, you think you will find that you can look at it differently. You can also suggest how we can change or retain it, wholesale modifications, so on and so forth. So having said that, talking about USA, how the country where everybody is talking about ethics, the lack of ethics in the legal profession. And after George Saraswat, somewhere in the 1960s, another academic called Anthony Cronman, he wrote a book called The Lost Lawyer, L-O-S-T. He was talking about the legal profession in USA virtually lost its track. Please book up that book, possible, I do not know. It's not available in the Supreme Court Bar Library. It is also not available in the Judges Library. But I think now it may be available in the Kindle or online. You may look at it, and it's a very interesting reading. And he makes one important observation. Let me read it for you. It is said that every profession is a job, and every professional makes a living by doing what she or he does. But not every job is a profession, and not every job is a way of life. Simple but beautiful. So if the legal profession has to be a way of life, and that's what the Constitution wants us to do, how do we make it? Do we think the legal profession is a way of life, or the professional contours stop in the court, in the law firm, in the office, and not beyond that? So it's a good question to ask. Is it a way of life? And in that context, let me identify four characteristics of the legal profession. Law is a public calling which involves a duty to serve the good of the community as a whole. Number one. Number two, despite the special branches of law, the profession remains the craft of a generalist. All of us, or many of us, or somebody asked me a question, sir, are you a tax lawyer or a criminal lawyer or this lawyer? I said, I'm all of that, jack of trades and master of none. So many of us are jack of trades, and don't be ashamed about it. So it's a lawyers perform a wide range of tasks, counseling clients, drafting documents, litigating, which involves moving around different areas of law. Then number three, the capacity, in my understanding, very important thing. The capacity of a lawyer for a judgment, which means not only intellectual skills, but also the development of perceptual and emotional powers. The clever lawyer who possesses a huge stockpile of technical information about the law and is adept at its manipulation, but who lacks the ability to distinguish between what is important and what is not, and cannot sympathetically imagine how things look and feel from his adversary's point of view, is not a good lawyer. Let me repeat. The clever lawyer who possesses huge stockpile of technical information about the law and is adept at its manipulation. I think many of us do it every second, third case we handle. We manipulate the law. Adept at its manipulation, but who lacks the ability to discern between what is important and what is not, and cannot sympathetically imagine how things look and feel from his adversary's point of view, he is not a good lawyer. I hope I am right. If an examiner asks you whether this is so, perhaps you should be able to answer that it is not so. That's the importance of an intellectual skill, the ability to argue a contrary point of view. So when I say this is not a good lawyer, and if you get a question on this, you should be able to say no, he or she can still be a good lawyer. That can be an intellectual skill, right? Your examiner wants to test your intellectual skill, not about what you'll argue in courts. Exactly. Now the fourth one, the faculty for judgment means what? The faculty for judgment means full complement of emotional, perceptual and intellectual powers. If you look at the hugely controversial cases the Supreme Court has been handling, let's say in the past 5 years, do not go beyond that. In the past 5 years, it's like a kaleidoscope of very controversial cases the court is doing, virtually touching upon every aspect of our life, from religion to faith to matrimonial relationships to equality of sexes to equality of opportunity and privacy and social accountability, governance. If you remember, in 1978, when Supreme Court was dealing with the first assembly dissolution case, State of Rajasthan versus Union of India, the court was talking about the political ticket doctrine, that courts would ordinarily not go into political issues, which borrowing what sometimes the US Supreme Court said, the lack of manageable standards, you know, for the court. But then we found the court moved on into Burmese case, where court said the decision-making process of the president or the governor can be subject to judicial review. And in other case related to Article 311(c)(2) some, I think A.K. Kaul was the Union of India, court said, you know, the subjective satisfaction of the president for removing somebody, you know, from service can still be subject to judicial review. So the scope of judicial review, which is so expanded, to actually look into every aspect of governance, right or wrong, is a different question. It's happening and we are allowing it to happen. Perhaps a lot of thinking on the political side, you know, people keep on talking about Supreme Court crosses the Lakshman Rekha. You know, don't cross the Lakshman Rekha. I do not know what the Lakshman Rekha is about. So we have all those problems. In the context of all the problems, how do you ask a question about a full complement of the emotional, perceptual and intellectual powers needed for a good judgment? So the very important components of a lawyer's mind. I am sharing with you, you know, jumping from subject to subject, point to point, but like, you know, playing on a, what's called ladders and snakes and ladders. I'm sorry for doing that. But in the shortest time possible, I thought, let me share all that information which I have gathered. And so this is important, compliments. Therefore, the study and practice of law looks both backwards and forwards. What we study is a study of the past and the efforts of the present and the march towards the future. So no study of law is complete with knowing the history of the law, and no study of the law is complete without knowing what exactly the object or the purpose of the law and how is it to be realized for the march towards future. So these are four characteristics of the practice of law. And how do you really apply them? A trial court lawyer, an appellate court lawyer, and many of us may practice in different courts. May not even practice. I remember, I must also share incidentally with you, because we have recently lost a great giant, the grand patriarch of law, legal education, Professor N.R. Madhav Menon. And I happened to be a student in Government Law College in Pondicherry in the mid-1970s. And recently we've been talking about the changing landscape of the legal profession and the need for legal profession. Young women and, you know, coming into the profession would probably be encouraged to explore new avenues of the legal profession. Not merely, you know, thronging the courts of law, but to enhance the quality and the purpose of the law by looking at alternate ways of being able to bring justice to the people. I think that's also an important aspect of professional ethics. Professional ethics is not merely confined to what we do according to the Bar Council of India rules. In the Bar Council of India rules, you can study them, you know, by rote, and if a question comes, tell me what is you understand about the Bar Council's prescription on duty, a variety of duties. Lawyers, a variety of duties, duty to a counsel, duty to a client, duty to the court, duty to the community. Bar Council enumerates a wide range of such duties. And in that context of the duties, can we now try to find out these important characteristics and see how these duties enumerated by the Bar Council of India ultimately is founded on these four or other five important facets of the practice of law. Just pick up the Bar Council of India rules and these three, four characters I'm talking about on two hands, look at the comparison. I think you will find there is a good deal of harmony, good deal of correspondence. Let me also throw some thinking process on some contemporary issues. Now we have the emergence of technology. There's one English academic called, he's also a writer, Richard Susskind. He writes about lawyers in the future and law without lawyers and so many books, Richard Susskind. So a very brief book was written recently on the compulsions of technology and how the legal profession will have to change and alter its, you know, role, its activities in the context of changing technological situations. Now, all of us know that there's a client-lawyer privilege issue. We call it confidentiality. you pick up any book on professional negligence, there are lots of books on professional negligence. Architects, engineers, you know, bankers and lawyers also figure in these books. For what purposes? That when you have not kept the confidentiality issue, adhere to it. Suppose I receive some important information which should have gone to somebody else and it's not meant to be addressed to my client, it has just reached my hands. It's a confidential information. I was thinking about it in the context of what happened when the leading law officers of the court were telling the Hindu, the newspaper, that look here, you are thieves. You stole information from the cabinet papers, and therefore you can be prosecuted for committing probably a penal offence. So in that Rafael case, all of you know that has been hugely written about. And so some confidential information, whether protected by RTA Act or not, so reaches your hand, what is your duty? Suppose it belongs to the opposite side and it wrongly comes to your hands, what's your duty? People say, why would I know? Why would I not use it? I can make some good money out of that. I can bargain, I can do so many things out of a very confident information. But perhaps you will do nothing of that sort. You will do simply nothing of that sort. You will put it in a sealed envelope and send it back to the sender and find out who is the real recipient of the information and see that it reaches him or her. That is honesty, that is professional ethics, isn't it? In that context, we all again look at the social media. So let me quickly read these issues. The emergence of technology-driven methods of communication, the internet, social media, etc., have thrown open several opportunities for crossing the lines of high professional ethical professional conduct. Today's wrongdoers and criminals, unrepentant lawbreakers, will not mind the use of lavish professional services. New fields of litigation and areas of social wrongs are also fertile grounds for highly priced legal services. I do not know how many of the leading lawyers in our country, including many of us in Supreme Court Bar, would say no to the request for somebody, if I call unrepentant lawbreakers. There are many in the community today. But I remember if Mr. Ramdev Panani would have been here, he would say, Constitution talks about lawyer. The lawyer is the one who does not sit in judgment over the conduct of the client. It's for the jury, it's for the court, it's for the community. You are nobody to sit in judgment. Maybe that's one point of view. But I talked about the early book written in England in the 12th century. Somewhere in the 14th century, another book was written. Very important, see. If they were required to take an oath of calumny, C-A-L-U-M-N-Y, means what? That the client is pursuing a honesty, you know, subject. So if you perceive that the client is not pursuing an honest issue, you have to give oath of declaration. That's called the oath of calumny. And you can discontinue. So if in the process of taking up a case, you find that your client's case is not all that just. Justice lies somewhere else. Do we have the option to discontinue? Do we have the option to give up the case? Do we have the obligation to ask it differently? Do we have an obligation to give it up? Or do we have the option to retain? So we are talking about ethical discretionary elements of decision making, at every stage of the profession. So technology today has thrown a lot of such issues and we can get in at the crossroads. The ethical discretion of a lawyer to make decision making is also a very hard choice. Many of us who may not have 100 cases a week, right, may have 100 cases in a year perhaps. Even that is a fortunate few. We'd be happy if we have 10 cases in a year. I know of people in the profession, not only here, elsewhere, in almost all parts of the country. We'd be happy if we have one case in a month, one case in a year. But they are still in the profession. So for them, how do we ask these questions? How do you answer this question? But the questions to be asked and answered is not for them. That's why I read about Professor Justice Maurice Gray talking about the unfortunate brethren. No. We are talking about it when we are in a comfortable position to be able to earn a decent livelihood through the profession. Once you reach that comfortable stage, then do we forget all about professional ethics? Is it only about till they reach that comfortable stage we battle with professional ethics? Or this, all these dimensions of ethical discretion in decision making is something like the umbilical cord which goes throughout our life. I think it is so. It's very important to look at it like that. Then few more very pedestrian aspects of it. I've been traveling in the clouds so far. Many abstract issues, lot of interesting high sounding phrases in philosophy. I think the examiner may also talk about when does a lawyer get caught by doing a wrong thing. We look at the Advocacy Act. The Advocacy Act, Section 35, is the one pivotal provision about advocates and professional misconduct and discipline proceedings under Section 36, so on and so forth. So the Advocates Act uses three important phrases. That is, when the Bar Council of India or the Bar Council of a state has reason to believe that somebody is guilty of a professional or other misconduct. What is this other misconduct? I am a drunken driver, I go every night home drunk. Is it other misconduct? I drink but I don't beat my wife, is it other misconduct? What is professional or other misconduct? How do you say professional misconduct, whatever that may mean? Meaning that by you will not charge excess fees, that you will not retain the client's briefs after the case is over, that you will not be dishonest with the client, that you will be courteous in the court, that you will not commit contempt of court. Read all the rules of the Bar Council of India. That is professional conduct and professional misconduct. But what is other misconduct? In the life of a civil servant, we have the CCL, CCA rules or conduct rules. A large number of those conduct rules. And that conduct rules talk about your private life also. So there are cases when I remember again in this book, Krishna, we are talking about the need to relax the rules, let's say in 1940s, that advocates should not engage in any trade or other calling other than the profession. He was talking about the need to relax that rule. What's the logic? We know that Bar Council of India prohibits that we should not engage in any office, employment, so on and so forth, once you've entered the profession. And whether we can be honorary managing directors or holding any such offices in companies, corporates, giving honorary advice, perhaps it's not forbidden. But the moment you enter into an office of profit, where you earn something, then the Bar Council of India rules you shall not do that. So in 1940s, Krishna Mehra talking about the need to relax that rule. I think it's important to look at it today. Just as important to look at what happened in the context of advertising. Advertising is still forbidden under the Bar Council of India rules. But pick up that very interesting judgment in the United States Supreme Court called Bates versus State of Arizona. Bates, B-A-T-E-S, Bates versus State of Arizona. 450 US 330, if I am not wrong. 450 US 330, 1977. Supreme Court, US Supreme Court said advertising is not bad. So today, in US, the attorneys community can advertise. But even thereafter, there are lots of questions about to what extent you can advertise. Bar Council of India says you can put on a website something about you, but not about advertising. Why do I raise all those questions about engaging in a trade or engaging in either employment, which can comfortably protect us from not falling into the sins of committing errors in the profession? So if an examiner were to ask you, what is wrong if lawyers were given the freedom to advertise and also given the freedom to engage in a trade or an employment, which does not militate with the legal profession standards. Suppose there's nothing wrong, money lending will militate. So then you will become a different person, human being. I know lawyers used to be money lenders, right? And but there are other honorable trades. Like you can be a good mediator while being a good lawyer. You can have a community service and set up an NGO, do a lot of good work. Will there be parfina? Why not? So question can be asked, and what's your answer to that? Then I thought, you know, when you're talking about this truth machine, etc., you know, that lie detector test, Supreme Court had said lie detector test is unconstitutional. This is Balakrishnan's judgment about that. It's not fair because we do not know how truthful it can be. The pitfalls of the technology is yet to be, you know, tested. So we have the DNA testing. After the DNA testing came, criminal law underwent a huge change. The investigating officer is able to detect crimes in a much more scientific and racial way than what it was before. So we have all those technological changes taking place. So whether, suppose I suggest tomorrow to the Bar Council of India, and that we should have a personality and character test to be conducted before any one of us are admitted into the bar. Suppose I say that tomorrow we should have a character test, personality test before we are admitted to the bar. Will that be unconstitutional? Will people not welcome it? I think the whole community will welcome it. I don't know. I'm just thinking on those lines. It's important. And judges are called to take up oath on the constitution. What do they say? Without fear or favor. But after taking the oath, what they do? Can we have a test on what they do every day? The only test is what they do by pronouncing judgments. That's the only demonstration of the loyalty to the constitution. But for a lawyer, there is no such test every day, no? So how do we test? So therefore, if the examiner were to ask you this question, what about a test like this, what will be your answer? Probably, suppose like an IAS question paper. You're also asked to say what could be the methods of testing character and you know, personality. How many of you know about the selection process for appellate judges in England, for Court of Appeals and now the Supreme Court of UK? While we are talking about NJAC in our country, judicial commissions, almost all over the world, there is an attempt to look at an independent process of appointing judges for superior courts. So in England, if you just look into it and search, and it's a very interesting reading. So those potential candidates who are probably appointed to the Court of Appeals will have to give a long, probably a 20-30 page long questionnaire. Very interesting questions. So a couple of questions are, have you ever cried in your life? Interesting question. And have you ever abused your position as an attorney or a lawyer? Have you ever abused your position? And have you ever thought that by not doing pro bono work, you miss something very important in life? Look at this kind of questions. They test your character, they test your personality. Maybe they can lie on the paper. But, so this is an important thing. I do not know. Like in England or USA, every 5 years you have to renew your bar position by taking an examination. People have been suggesting it even in India. There will be a huge outcry. Bar Council of India will shut it down, perhaps. I do not know about that. So we have lots of controversies in our country on this advancement of you know, ethical values. Now, having said that, I got a lot of short of time. I was talking about that article section 35A, I just forgot to talk about the first part of it, namely reason to believe. No, what is the reason to believe? How do you give a meaning to the word reason to believe? like we discussed about the definition of proof, proved in the Evidence Act. So we all know that it is not like proof beyond reasonable doubt as far as disciplinary proceedings are concerned. It is a preponderance of probability. And there's an important judgment in 1966, barium chemicals case. Nothing to do with professional misconduct of Section 33A, but that is, and the old Industries and Development Regulation Act, which is no longer good law. And if the government of India is of the opinion that that particular industry is being run contrary to public interest, ease of opinion or ease of the view, reason to believe, they're all more or less the same expression. So there are very interesting views in the judgment. One is by Justice Hidayatullah, the other by Justice Shailat, talking about it is not what you think that there is some reason to believe, but objective materials must exist on the basis of which you will form an opinion. It is not merely a subjective mental process. So the reason to believe in the context of disciplinary proceedings, while it is a very relaxed standard, like preponderance of probability, then what survives if it is only a preponderance of probability and not strict? Why can't we say that reason to believe must be a strict, that that if there is slightest misconduct proved, to throw the burden on a client to prove misconduct would be wrong, and like in the Narcotics Act or the Tara Act, etc., and also in the money laundering legislation, the burden is on the accused to prove that a certain thing has not happened. And how many of you are familiar with the Justice Mallivat Committee report? And Professor Madhavan was also part of that, where they made a very famous statement that the accused can be asked to make a statement in the court, not like 313 statement, but if there is reason to believe that the accused has committed an offense, why can't he be asked to disclose whether he has committed an offense or not? Very, very important debate. So why not this reason to believe be made more strict and tight so that there will be less scope for lawyers to commit professional misconduct? How do you advance this thesis? How do you rewrite Section 35A? Just keep it in mind. We also know that what happened in the case of that Allahabad lawyer E.C. Mishra and great misconduct, and the contempt of courts act actions were taken against him, and later the Supreme Court Bar Association case, the view was reversed. And the question is, what are the powers of the Supreme Court under Article 129, the power to commit contempt 129, and the powers under the Advocacy Act to deal with professional misconduct? Are they same? Do they overlap? Or the contempt power under Section Article 129 will not run into the field of the Advocates Act? If not, why? Why can't you say that the Supreme Court, we have a provision, I think that the Supreme Court rules 2013, Chapter 4A, something like that, where the name of an advocate and record on the rolls of the registrar of the court can be struck off if the court finds there is a misconduct. So then, if there is a contempt in the face of the court, it is one species of contempt, and the court says remove this lawyer from the rolls of the court, will it be valid, legal, or will it run foul of the Advocates Act? So the Advocates Act is superior, or Article 129 being a constitutional power, being a constitutional provision, etc., is superior. But some points of view, very well considered points of view in England was that that the power to make any observation or remarks against the public or any person will have to be conferred by legislation. You understand the importance of the statement? The power to do anything ultimately comes from a law, isn't it? The authority of law means rule of law. Rule of law means authority of law. So the power to do anything must come from some law. So if Article 129 does not have any detailed provision as to deal with professional misconduct in the face of the court, Unless there is some law which empowers the court to do so, can the court do like that? So will you say something about a sexual or public if they're not an opportunity of being heard? So 129, can it be a charter for such a wide disciplinary action against even seemingly erring advocates? So whether Advocacy Act is superior or 129 is superior? How would constitutional lawyers answer this question? Right? Balancing or what? Maybe you have to answer. Pardon? The statute will prevail. Constitution will prevail. You have to give reason why it should prevail. Merely because it's not a constitution. Pardon? Alright, fine. I say somebody has committed a contempt of court. I can only do what the contempt of court law authorizes me to do. Can I travel beyond the Contempt of Courts Act? The Contempt of Courts Act 1971 is applicable to all courts, including Supreme Court. So 129 is only a source of authority. Alright, fair enough. But the source of authority, if it doesn't go to the extent of saying you can do this A, B, C, D, can you say the source of authority will be construed widely? Then what about reasonable opportunities? Right? Then what about excessive powers being acquired under the rubric of a constitutional provision? You'll have to debate it. Very important questions to debate, no? No part of the constitution can be assumed to be so overwhelming that there is no answer or a question or a debate against it. Right? Recently I find, in some case Supreme Court was talking about a sub judice rule. About a couple of months ago. I don't think I need to name the honorable judges who are talking about it. But there is this issue whether if a matter is pending before the Supreme Court and hugely controversial cases, what is the limitation? What are the limitations of the role of the profession in discussing, debating, and talking about this case, the pending case? All of us know the sub judice doctrine means if a matter is pending before a court, reasonable restraint will be exercised for expressing any opinion in order that what the English court says in Attorney General versus Times newspaper, 1974, Three All England Report, 499. Substantial risk of prejudice. So if a comment will involve a risk of prejudicing an issue pending before the court, all of us know that many of us do not bother about this very important fine distinctions. There is an online media, there is 24/7, there is the big fight. So televisions open all kinds of opportunities for us to go argue the case in the morning and go in the evening before the television and express our views. Fair enough, Article 19(1)(a) is very wide. But don't you think there should be some kind of limitation on that? And if so, why? In the context of we have a large number of cases on comments being offered before trial commences, particularly in the context of trial courts. Comments being offered before trial commences, in the course of trial, or after conclusion of trial, on the sense and the footing that it may possibly affect, for instance, in a country like England and USA, where there's a jury system. The juries are, after all, a common layman and woman. They are not known to the intricacies of law and evidence and proof. They are actually emotionally, more prompted to reach a conclusion. So a comment that can be made in the course of a trial, at the end of a trial, can virtually affect the outcome of a legal process. So therefore, care is taken in those countries that, for instance, in England, under the Contempt of Courts Act, the English court has the power to order a postponement of a publication, if in the court, in the mind, in the opinion of the court, it will prejudicially, or called substantially, you know, have the affecting the process of justice. We don't have such a power in India. Our contempt of court side does not have such a provision. Therefore, I ask this question, suppose Article 129 is used tomorrow. Supreme Court is hearing some matter, and the judges say 129 is available to us to stop a publication of anything which happens in the court. Will it be constitutional? The subject is rule, how far it can be extended. So what is more important? The right to freedom of speech and expression, the right of parties to a litigatory process, to have a fair adjudicatory process, or the community's interest to know what's happening, the transparency of everything which is happening in the court. Which one is more important? Or they are equally important, how do you balance them? Very challenging questions. And fortunately or unfortunately for us, we don't have any judgment on this issue, except for instance, I remember 1988, Savisachi Mukherjee's judgment in that Reliance Petrochemical, I think, judgment, where some capital issues when Reliance was publication of its debentures, and there were serious questions about the Reliance issuing these debenture issues, whether they are bona fide, so on and so forth. So the capital issues controlling authority was one of the respondents. Writings are, publications are being made in newspapers that this particular authority has not acted bona fide, and in the Supreme Court, court was talking about the need to balance. So if people will be persuaded to form a particular point of view in their transactions, in their public transactions, a very classic case where there were such writings, I would be dissuaded in investing in Reliance. That will be different from other ordinary cases where you are not going to have a relationship with an accused or victim or so and so, but you will have your perceptions on the outcome of a case considerably affected by what is written on the online media. Sorry to say that many of us who write in the online media have lost our sense of decorum and decency. We use all kinds of language, unfortunately. So, very derogatory language. So it's a very important question on the subject of doctrine 19.1a, and to what extent can it be extended. I think I have said finally whatever I wanted to say, except one small area, which is a broad statement again. I have picked up some judgments on professional after misconduct. I can have it circulated for you. And it's also of interest to know that we're talking about professional ethics at a universal level. Somewhere in 1990, the United Nations Congress, or the 8th United Nations Congress on the Prevention of Crime and the Treatment of Offenders, they outline basic principles on the role of lawyers. These are called the UN Principle on the Role of Lawyers. And when I was looking at these, they're not big in number, nothing very new about what they're saying. As I was beginning our lecture today about what happened in 12th century and the War Council, I look at it and find the same thing being repeated here. Means what? Means that some aspects of human conduct, right and wrong, have remained the same. Regardless of march of history, regardless of all this talk about rule of law, French Revolution, Marxist Revolution, so on and so forth. So we have this challenge, ultimate fundamental challenge to the human nature, human conduct, but it is more poignant in the context of law as a profession. The more you understand the poignancy of this importance of ethics, the more I think you will be rewarded in playing a modest role of being an agent of a social change. I consider myself with it, the role of a lawyer. I walk in and walk out every day in the court. Then I go to universities and law schools. I tell them every day I walk in and walk out of the court. I am not handling merely a case. I am not merely looking at a case in the court. I am looking at a mirror of the society in the court. What happens in the court is just a mirror of what's happening in the society. You collect all the 300-odd, you know, cases in our cost list on Friday and Monday and Friday. If somebody attempts to do that and find out what exactly is happening in these Mondays and Fridays in all these cases, I think it's all a mirror of what is happening outside, a complete failure of the inability of systems outside, people outside, in not being able to resolve their problems on grounds of what honesty, fairness, reciprocity, kinship, all that lacking, everything lands in the court. And you want judges of the court to be super woman and super man of all possible, you know, extent. Very difficult, no? I think therefore it's important for us to talk about professional ethics. The more we play a radical and a good role, I think judges' task of giving fair outcomes will be considerably assisted. We forget all that. We only want to stand up on either side, the roaring lions as well as the soft ones. I remember the Justice Krishna, when I'll conclude with this observation, when he went to the High Court of Australia after retirement, he sat in the High Court. And after he came back, he watched proceedings in the court. And Krishna Iyer was a very tall judge, the greatest, one of the greatest judges the court has produced. And there were occasions to move with him very closely. So he came and said, looking at what those lawyers are doing in the High Court and compared to what our lawyers are doing, they seem to be angels whispering in courts. He said, the Australian lawyers seem to be angels whispering in courts. And that is what they are doing as a lawyering job, compared to what our lawyers are doing in our courts. The whispering part of it, and being angelic, no? Are we doing it here? So let us end on that note. I think we have one more lecture at 11:30. I will have all this passed on to you, either on the net or somebody through the registrar. That Reliance Petrochemical judgment is 1988, supplement SCR 212. Supplement SCR, I think. Supplement 3 SCR, usually. Just take it up. And a very great judge like this is Venkataramani in that Rajiv Kumar Garg versus Shanti Bhushan, 1994. The Committee on Judicial Accountability wrote something about the judge's conduct. A very polite but a very nice expression used by Judge Venkataramani. Pick up the judgment, it's a very short judgment, about 2 pages. So he says, somewhere in the process, the fine way of making a point is lost. He says, somewhere in the process, the fine way of making a point is lost. Which means what? The language we use. And so, the same thing can be conveyed in different ways. If you say that somebody is misrepresented in the court, you can say, this person is lying. This man is not telling the truth. You can convey it very differently, you know, in the court. So language is very important. So let's end with that. Thank you for your attention. And I wish we had more time. This book, please pick it up and read it. I'll leave it in the Supreme Court Bar Library for your sake. And it's very important to read.
Sir, what did yesterday buy?
That I don't know. Justice Patan is not my cup of tea. I suppose that I've given you sufficient hints and what.
Who is the author, sir? Who is the author of Doing Justice? Deep.
Okay.